Panorama TV presents How'd They Do That, where we explore the world of professional photographers and share their techniques with you. Here's your host, Mark Wallace.
Welcome to this week's episode of How'd They Do That. This week, we're joined by Ab Sesay. He is the creative director for the Mac Group and a wonderful photographer. Thanks for joining us this week, Ab.
Thank you.
Well, tell us a little bit about your work. I know you do a lot of product photography for the Mac Group, as well as a lot of fashion photography for your own portfolio. So can you walk us through a little bit of your normal work week and the kind of things that you shoot?
So I started here at the Mac Group as a photographer, in which I photographed all their brands, everything from bags, cameras, tripods, light meters, pocket wizards, things of that nature. Also photographing people using our products in scenarios for things like brochures, catalogs, and for online descriptions and things of that nature as well.
Okay, well that's a lot of work, Ab. For people that don't know who the Mac Group is, can you just tell us a few of the brands that they represent?
The Mac Group, here at the Mac Group, we represent brands such as Saucony, Profoto, Mamiya, Pocket Wizard, Temba, Enduro, Benro, X-Rite.
That is a lot of stuff. So you have access pretty much to a lot of really high-end gear. So when you set out to do a photo shoot or take pictures or something, what's the gear that you find yourself using more often than not? What kind of cameras and lenses and lighting equipment do you use regularly?
As far as cameras, for all my product work, I use Mamiya DL28, which is basically Mamiya with a digital back. And for most of my people work, I've transferred over from using a digital back to a Canon 5D Mark II. And lighting-wise, I use all Profoto. I use a meter, I use Pocket Wizards and the Pro Air system, depending on what I'm doing, as well as color checkers. For me, color is very important.
Well, let's talk a little bit more about the kind of work that you do, your personal work. So looking at your website at absesay.com, I've noticed that you use a lot of hard light in your portraits. How do you work with hard light and do it so well?
For me, using hard light was part of me scaling down, which means when I was in school, I always dreamed of having a ton of equipment and all these other things that I thought would make my photography really good. And once I got to a point where I had access to almost anything I wanted, the problem was getting all of it onto location. And therefore, I scaled down. I started using a lot of basic reflectors. I started making the transition over into the 5D Mark II. And when lighting with hard light, the position of it is very important. And also understanding how the light shaper is going to affect your light. Because the one thing about hard light sources, and particularly I use the Magnum reflector a lot, I use the narrow beam reflector, I use a 5-foot reflector, I use both the silver and the white beauty dishes. And one thing that can fool you about hard light sources that are parabolic, meaning the way they kind of focus light, is at times it goes against things like the inverse square law, meaning that you could be 1 foot further away from the light and your f-stop actually increases, because that's where all the light lines are starting to converge. And when lighting with hard light, another reason I like it is hard light is very efficient, meaning a lot of reflectors that are hard light sources are extremely efficient. Therefore, you can dial your power packs way down and still be shooting around F11. So therefore, your recycle is always fast. And when I'm working with people, having a fast recycling time, for me, is everything.
Well, speaking about hard light, Ab, there is a photo shoot that you did with Mario Barth, who's a celebrity tattoo artist, and there's some photos that you took that I really want to dig into. But before we get to those photos, I also noticed there were two photos of Mario that you shot. One was him putting on a necklace, and one that looked like he was by a makeup counter, just sort of getting ready for the shoot. Was that something that you planned before the shoot, or is that something that was sort of organic that happened during a shoot?
That is something I did not plan on doing that day. One thing that I do is when anytime I'm shooting a celebrity, and I've transferred this over to fashion, but one thing about my work is oftentimes shooting people, up-and-coming artists, musicians, celebrities, but shooting them in the context of fashion, which means things like clothing, wardrobe, which helps lend itself to what the look and feel is of that day, is very important. And also, when I shoot people, I'm also normally shooting people outside of what their everyday is. So it's not really a portrait, but that's why I say it's kind of like in the context of fashion, because in some cases we are playing dress up. This is not how they appear every day. And one thing I do that allows me to kind of walk around the set and sneak images of my subject, similar to what I did with Mario there, which while he was getting ready, I just went into the dressing room with the 5D, cranked the ISO up a little bit, had an on-camera flash, which I didn't use, but I had just in case I wanted to, is it allows me kind of to document the day. And I felt it was really important to do that because oftentimes when I'm on set, you know, people are, you know, everyone's getting ready, somebody will snap a picture with their iPhone and it's amazing. And everybody's looking at it like, wow, that's an amazing picture on the iPhone. So I felt like while I have downtime on set, I should have my camera and I should be walking around and taking other pictures that are amazing of these moments kind of just happening, because oftentimes the clients, that's what they want. Which means if someone looks at you in the eye and says, I need you to capture me natural and I need it to look unposed, it's never gonna happen. But if you're ready for those moments as they're happening, there's never a need for them to say that. And that's a very important part of portraiture.
Well, that, you know, what you're saying there, being prepared for not just in the studio location where you have the light set up, but backstage basically, is a lot similar to what Gene Lauer was telling us previously about shooting football, which is plan for one shot, but be prepared to take any shot possible. So that's interesting that you're applying the same techniques for fashion as Gene did for football. That's really interesting. Well, another couple of pictures that you took with Mario were, one was him against a concrete wall. So could you quickly walk us through the lighting setup for that shot and tell us specifically how you lit it, metered it, and how did you get that shot?
For the portrait of Mario against the metal wall, I wanted a light that kind of fell off evenly across him. And I wanted to pull back to kind of flatten out the image a little bit. So as far as camera-wise, I shot with a Canon 5D Mark II with a 70 to 200 millimeter lens. And as far as lighting, it's simply lit with a Profoto white beauty dish that had a grid, a 25 degree grid over it. So I got a nice even fall off, but I still had a decent area for the subject to work in.
Well, there's one more shot of Mario that we want to talk about, and it's the shot of him that he's in a director's chair by a film projector. So tell us about how you balance that light coming straight out of the film camera projector with the, looks like, ambient light. So how did you light that scene?
I had Mario in a director's chair, and I had his partner Billy in front of him in a lower director's chair. I took the projector, I aimed it at a piece of white foam core, acting like it was projecting on the wall. I took a picture, looked at what my lighting was, found out where I needed to accent it to get the things in the image to stand out the way I wanted them to stand out. Instead of using strobes, I used magnum reflectors. I used a magnum reflector to give Mario a little bit of light, and then I used another magnum reflector on Billy to give him a little bit of light, and just shot with the modeling lights without even the strobes going off. I love shooting with all available light whenever I can, because it makes me feel as if though I'm in most control, because I don't have to wait. The only bad part to it is that you always need something for your subjects to kind of react to give you like a different look, a different pose. So not having the flashes go off sometimes is a bit of a problem, but in this case I was close enough to them where they could hear my shutter, so they were still able to give me slight little variations kind of as they were moving through doing what they were doing until they settled into that right pose so I can get the camera.
Well, that's awesome, Ab. Well, unfortunately we're out of time this week, but thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Awesome. Well, to see more of Ab's work, you can go to his website at absesay.com, or as always, just go to the Adorama Learning Center, where you can see more tips about photography and how to do some of the things that Ab talked about in this episode, as well as seeing some of the shots that Ab took. And as always, if you have some questions about photography or photography-related equipment, you can send those to me at askmark@adorama.com. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week.
This episode is brought to you by Adorama TV. Visit the Adorama Learning Center, where you'll find photography tips and techniques, links to the gear used in this episode, and related videos. For all the latest photography, video, and computer gear, visit Adorama.com. And the next time you're in New York City, visit our store, located on 18th Street between 5th and 6th Avenue.